IVM.
Welcome to Dreaming with Your Eyes Open. Ronnie Screwvala is an entrepreneur who I have admired for a long time. His ability to make inroads in an industry that is so tightly controlled by a few was what first had me so impressed. When he released his book a few years ago, I lapped it up and was even more impressed. The more I discovered his journey and the various businesses he had been a part of, the deeper my admiration went. When this project came up, I jumped on it wholeheartedly. Where else was I going to get the opportunity to spend so much time discussing the ins and outs of his career and what he has accomplished? On episode 6, I discussed the chapter The Outsiders with Ronnie. We discussed some of the benefits and challenges of being an outsider, and also we talk a little bit about how you hold your own in a David Goliath situation that might occur as an outsider. Hi, Ronnie.
Hi.
We're going to be talking about a chapter called The Outsider. So I want to ask you a couple of things around this. I want to actually kind of go back to like the intro parts that we were talking about as well, right? You talk about yourself as an outsider quite often, right? And so one of the things I wanted to ask you is that what do you think are the benefits of being an outsider versus the challenges of being an outsider, right? So I mean, like when you were talking about the first...
I guess when you're an outsider, you can be pretty alone and can be lonely.
Okay.
And I guess the benefits are you can get away with a lot in many aspects. When there is a context of precedence or to the manner born, then you're following some sense of etiquette. You're sending a sense of hierarchy, a sense of family custom, whatever else. Mm-hmm. So I think that it can be quite liberating to be, you know, not that.
So I remember the story from the intro chapters, right, where you were talking about the movie Dil Ke Sharoke Mein, one of the failures, I guess, that you would call it. But in that chapter, you were talking about how you were watching the trial, and as you were watching the trial, you saw a scene with the snake drinking milk or something like that. And you were just, you know,
cringing.
I mean, like, you were flabbergasted, right? I mean, like at that
point. Well, I was cringing more than flabbergasted, but yes.
But my question then is, it felt like at that point when I was reading through the introduction that you kind of got liberated in the sense that you no longer felt that you needed to defer to insiders. Is that true?
Yes. I think there was no question about that. Yeah. I mean, in that sense, I was taking the full risk. I was the last man standing.
Right.
It had to be my particular call. I was cringing. I was definitely not looking at how other people would view it.
Right.
But at the same time, I wanted to see how one would be able to cut one losses or invest in a long-term brand and many of the other thought processes. Right. But I think if you don't have that belief in yourself, then you have to question why you're doing this. Because you start something, take the risk, then ask five people, what do you think? What do you think? Then it's a recipe for disaster.
But I mean, like, you're not asking too many people what they think. You're trying to push.
Let's be very clear. I'm a strong believer in getting a lot of research done, and getting a lot of focus groups done on anything that one does, from a product to a technology to anything one does. But I think at the end of the day, when you come to a call and taking that final decision with your experience, it has to be yours.
Okay. So how would you say that working on a project like that, which did not work out the way that you would like to, right? How would that kind of a project kind of move you in? Do you think that that was kind of transformative in the way that you kind of approached
this
stuff?
Well, it was transformative in the sense that it was really high profile failure that I hadn't seen before.
Okay.
And if I could withstand that, then it kind of seasoned me for a lot more. Mm-hmm. It also, again, went back to, but I'm backing it, so it has to make sense to me rather than, I don't know much about it. I'm the outsider, so I might as well depend on other people.
Right.
That was a distinguishing penny-dropping moment for that.
Right. Another thing that I wanted to ask you about this is, so in the Outsider chapter, you were talking about your relationship with the director, Anurag Basu. We've all been told a handshake is sufficient and a word is good as oak, but businesses often turn in unexpected ways. Although my policy is never to compromise, you've got to be realistic. If enforcing an agreement isn't productive, then do what's best to protect a long-term business and a relationship. If the long-term is no longer relevant, maybe enforcing a clause is best.
Correct. Absolutely.
Right? When you say do not compromise, you say you don't want to compromise. What are the things which make you think that, what are the factors that you look at where you say that, okay, you know what, in this case, it's just probably better to let it go?
The key part of everything that you read, there was long-term or non-long-term.
Right.
If it's a one-off relationship, then I think you need to stick with what you'll agreed and then, you know, draw the line in the sand. Mm-hmm. If it's a long-term one, you need to take a long-term view.
Right.
What am I letting go in the short term? How genuine is the request from the other side? Mm-hmm. How genuine is the other party when they're breaching, deviating, not being able to live up to their thought process?
Right.
Cut to 2 years later when I want to have this relationship ongoing. Mm-hmm. Will this be a deterrent? I'll be taking a short-term loss, but I'll be taking a long-term gain. All of that comes right into the picture.
And you worked with him again, right?
So I mean, again, this is not just based on relationships. Right. I'm giving this in every aspect of life. Whether you have a long-term relationship and a collaborative agreement, mm-hmm. you have to let go of sometimes if there's a long-term relationship. Right. If not, then you know exactly where it goes, where it has to go.
In which case you are like, okay, let's stick to the letter of what we decided on. Right.
Having said that, I just want to clarify that even if it's on a one-time relationship mm-hmm. with people, life is a circle.
Right.
And you never know when that person or that individual or that organization or company you might be doing business with or anything else later on. Even in that situation, you need to stand for what is right and mm-hmm. fair and try and work that out in the most constructive manner. I think being aggressive and destructive and destroying relationships is not most productive.
Okay. As we go on to this chapter, you start talking a little bit about the ways when you were approaching different people who are traditional Bollywood people, right? You had spoken to ABCL, you had spoken to Mr. Yash Chopra, you had spoken to a number of people around the idea of kind of creating a joint venture. So your team at that point in time was of the view that you must take on a partner. You were a little hesitant, right? How do you kind
of
go against...
Well, I think the decision was I had a large team.
Right.
I had multiple divisions. Mm-hmm. One division was adding too much risk profile to the others.
Right.
And could also take many of the others down. Mm-hmm. Therefore, there was concern between the team that, you know, one or two of my bad decisions in a flamboyant manner may actually affect the lives of 1,000 people.
Right.
We had a very open culture, so therefore everyone could speak on that. So that was one criteria. Right. I think the second one is about risk. When you own 100% of the company and you're the last man standing, you can take whatever risk you want to. Right. But when you've got other investors and other people and team members, you need to take a much more pragmatic view on things. And that was the other call there, that I may not have personally liked to have been gotten into a partnership, especially when in a non-consensuous business like in the creative field. But it made sense to actually go out and explore all the opportunities to see what's out there.
Right.
And maybe allow those circumstances of such a thing to come in and help me decide either favorably or unfavorably.
Right. So you eventually decided not to go there, but at the same time you were...
But it was also not that I had four very favorable situations and then I decided not to.
Right.
It was, there was nothing compelling about what I thought would help us propel us to the next level in a collaboration that was there, etc. So there wasn't actually most of these, there was a cross.
Right. Also, I think one of the challenges that you mentioned over here is that if you take on a partner like in that situation, it would be a kind of a big brother, little brother situation where you would not get to be the big brother. You would not be able to build your own brand in that space, right?
Yeah.
So I'd be like, you know, what would you say are the factors that should come into something like that, a decision like that?
No, I think that depends on, you know, it depends on your approach on big brother or non-big brother. I think in those particular cases, I didn't have any thought process or any hesitation that we would not stand our own.
Right.
I worked and we partnered with Disney, and that's pretty much a David and Goliath in every sense of the word.
True.
But where we were in the markets we felt we were holding our own from that point of view. So I don't think that was a criterion for me, and it should not be a criterion for everyone if you can hold your own.
Okay, so I'm going to read a line. I was concerned that we would never be able to build our own identity
or
brand.
Yes, so the question is own brand.
Right.
Yeah, when you, it's like anything that is a collaborative.
Right.
Okay, it's like Hero Honda, and then one fine day Honda says, I'm Honda, and Hero says, I'm Hero.
Right.
And then you need to go your own way. So that would happen in many ways, in many contexts. Where the most difficult thing is to collaborate.
How much of a factor was the brand aspect of it, right? Because I mean, like, if you wanted to build,
I was just converting from a B2B to a B2C business,
right,
and one of the main reasons why I was taking on that risk and that entire challenge mm-hmm. was to build a brand,
right?
And especially in a high-profile situation like that, if I felt the brand would not stand out, mm-hmm. and could, I mean, I may stand hold my own in terms of decision making,
right.
But if the brand of a larger did not stand out, then it would have been a problem.
There's a statement that you make over here, right? When an external resource or consultant joins any discussion, that entity needs to prove his value. Often his presence isn't wholly productive. The second meeting didn't get very far and we let it pass. This seems like something you've had experience with.
Yeah. And I think that's not in context of everything we've spoken about
right
now.
It's slightly different.
Yeah.
It's part of the same story aspects, but I thought that it was an interesting piece.
Yes, and I think you need to understand when there's a third person in the room,
right.
You need to understand what that person is adding.
Right.
Now, that third person may still be in the room because it's brought by the other party,
mm-hmm.
but you need to assess what role they're going to play, because it could be a very productive role,
mm-hmm.
it could be a very objective role, it could be a very subjective role, and it could be a very destructive
role. What's your experience been with this kind of stuff, though? I mean, like, have you met people across or who have interacted in all of those ways?
I think in different situations, it's a challenge.
Okay.
Because I think they don't understand the agenda from both sides. Mm-hmm. They definitely need to add their own value.
Right.
It just depends on who they retain with. Okay. As far as I'm concerned, if they're representing the side they're representing, as far as I'm concerned, I look at them as part of the other side.
Right. Okay. So as we continue on this, right? So, I mean, like you decided to pass on the Bollywood, different partnerships that you could have made with different Bollywood houses.
And global studios like Fox and Sony.
So I wanted to talk a little bit about the Sony studio, right? I mean, like the Sony deal, you essentially just kind of, you had a call at, so basically yeah. they asked you for a midnight call and you're like, no. Right. And I mean, like, we're going to walk away.
Yeah.
Can you tell us a little bit about
that? I think that was me being a little impetuous.
Okay.
I mean, it's not a very rational thing to do.
Right.
But I do feel that when you've got a David and Goliath situation, if you're not going to hold your own,
right,
then they're going to walk all over you.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying that organization would, but most people would. So that to me is a sign. I mean, why would, if somebody's not willing to get onto the phone on the other side at midnight, right, why do they expect me to get on the phone at midnight?
Right.
And we're equals. If we're not equals, I have a problem in the first place. Right. So it was just not being impetuous. It was also very symbolic mm-hmm. of mutual respect.
Right. I think that that comes across very clearly, right? I mean, like when I was reading the chapter, to me, it came across as they were, the interactions did not seem like they were going in a positive direction. And the way that it seemed like they were trying to treat
you. Just to be clear, and I think we have to draw lessons from here, not really talk about the people. Now, So, and I think just to be clear on that, you could have different people in the value chain, especially right. when you're suddenly dealing on a business point of view, when everyone's shaking hands.
Right.
Then the next level is the more difficult and tricky one.
Right. Right.
Because that's when lawyers come in. That's when commercial and finance and accounts people come in. Mm-hmm. And they have a job to do. And therefore, they're looking at it a lot more black and white.
Right.
So if you haven't moved to from the grays of doing a deal and shaking hands to the black and white, and if you haven't acclimatized to that, it could be quite alien.
That's an interesting point of that we should kind of, I think, maybe explore a little bit, right? I mean, like, how does that happen, right?
No, it's very important. Then either you hand it over to a black and white person, but
right.
If you're the person who's just struck a deal and then you want to own it all and then be part of that, you need to understand that the language, the rhetoric is going to change and it's going to be a lot more clinical.
Actually, I think that's a really interesting point. So again, I'm going to end this on a quote from the book. Identity is often built on branding and creating impressions. Here was a classic case of branding, not through a campaign, but by doing pioneering work one could be proud of. And this is, you were talking about Rang De Basanti and those kinds of
things. I think you're talking about any brand. I think today young entrepreneurs think that going with a campaign is building a brand.
Right.
No, you're building awareness.
Right.
The only way you can build brand is by your track record, actually. It's your track record that builds your brand.
Okay. So you were talking about ethos. I think you were saying that the ethos of a brand comes across in the kind of work that
you do,
right?
Yeah, it is. In the kind of your products, the kind of your service, what the consumer thinks of you, and not what you're telling the consumer you stand for.
Do you think the fact that you were an outsider helped with kind of create, like QTV is an iconic brand, right? In the film space and in the entertainment space just generally. Do you think the fact that you were an outsider allowed you to kind of look at that brand a little more differently than the way that a lot of more film business before you got into it was mostly a family
business,
right?
Yeah, I think it was the DNA that I came with.
Yeah.
I'm not sure I can prophesize whether it would have been very differently.
Mm-hmm.
But I think I sort of revel in that outsider approach. I mean, I think I'm in the online education business, and I'm an outsider there.
Right.
I've never had that university background. I'm not a teacher. I don't come from that faculty. I don't have pedagogy experience.
Mm-hmm.
And again, if I take sports, for example, I'm still an outsider there. What do I know about kabaddi and football and volleyball?
Right. But you think that helps, right? The fact that you can look at this with fresh eyes and kind of like think, okay, this is where
I can look at it with a lot more objectivity and with a lot more distance.
And in terms of...
And less personal and more brand.
Yeah, exactly.
I think that in some of these businesses in the service, you kind of mix up your personal brand with the brand of the organization.
Right.
And that could be a problem.
Interesting. All right. I think that's a great place to end this episode, and we'll be back next week.
Yeah, lovely. See you then.
Did you know that Parsis in Mumbai, instead of being left at the Tower of Silence after they die, are now cremated? And why? Because a cow fell sick in the early 1990s. Did you know that the smog in Delhi is caused by something that farmers in Punjab do and that there's no way to stop them? Did you know that there wasn't one gas tragedy in Bhopal, but three? One of them was seen, but two were unseen. Did you know that many well-intentioned government policies hurt the people they're supposed to help? Why was demonetization a bad idea? How should GST have been implemented? Why are all our politicians so corrupt when not all of them are bad people? I'm Amit Verma, and in my weekly podcast, The Seen and the Unseen, I take a shot at answering all these questions and many more. I aim to go beyond the scene and show you the unseen effects of public policy and private action. I speak to experts on economics, political philosophy, cognitive neuroscience, and constitutional law so that the insights can blow not only my mind, but also yours. The Seen and the Unseen releases every Monday. So do check out the archives and follow the show at seenunseen.in. You can also subscribe to The Seen and the Unseen on whatever podcast app you happen to prefer.
Hi, my name is Anupam Gupta. I'm B50 on Twitter. I am the host of Paisa Paisa, the show that talks money. On my show, I speak to experts from every field of money and finance, from stock markets, equities, debt funds, credit cards, life insurance, every possible area of money and finance that you can think of. We even did an episode on cryptocurrency. I've got fantastic guests from mutual funds to personal finance experts everywhere, robo-advisory startups, just name it, we've got it. At Paisa Paisa, we help you make smart decisions about money. You work hard for money. Now make your money work hard for you. New episodes out every Monday, and you can listen to my show on the IVM Podcast app or any other podcasting app that you have. Paisa Paisa is brought to you by Paytm Money.